some questions that have come on the basis of my last two lectures. One question concerned, how do we actually obtain the map from a set of differential equations? That was the question that you had. Well, if you have a set of differential equations, its solution will give, say, an orbit something like this, right? And I said you place a Poincare section and you look at the piercings, right? So, in that case, you have the Poincare section say here, and you start from a point on the Poincare section and you go around following the differential equation and it lands somewhere, right? And you are trying to find out this point is x n plus 1 y n plus 1 and this point was x n y n. So, you are trying to find this as a function of that. Therefore, this evolution contains the information about the map, right? The difficulty is that this is all very fine, but you cannot obtain a closed form expression of the map this way. So, yeah, the nth piercing to the n plus 1th piercing. I am not talking about how much time it goes. So, nth piercing to n plus 1th piercing and then n plus 2th piercing, so on and so forth. In between, there can be various different times. Then you'd write a code to solve the set of differential equations starting from this initial condition, giving the termination condition as again coming back to this plane. Now, this will be a chunk of code, right? Maybe using fourth order Runge-Kutta method, you solve it and then. So, effectively the map becomes a chunk of code where you give the x n y n as input. It turns out x n plus 1 y n plus as output. So, no, it will be the same because same equations have been solved and the termination condition is that you come back to the same plane. I am not talking about how long you have to evolve. I am talking about the termination condition is that there will be if you are doing a Runge-Kutta method, you are taking basically steps. In one step, it is actually solving the equations. Actually solving the equation. So, ultimately, it will be a chunk of code, a program, right? That program will have as input x n y n, will give as an output x n plus 1 y n plus 1. So, that is the map. You can do everything numerically with it, but you can do nothing analytically with it, right? Because you cannot differentiate a chunk of code, right? What do you do then? What actually is done is that if you have a situation like this, you plot, suppose it was originally a two-dimensional set of differential equations, you place a Poincare section, it becomes a 1D. In a 1D, you can plot the graph of the map. So, we plot the graph of the map, whatever you obtain by solving these differential equations. So, you suppose you get something like this. We know that in this part, it sort of closely resembles the one-hump quadratic function. So, then we say that in this part, we can approximate it by the quadratic function and behavior will be more or less captured by the quadratic function. See, basically the same reason as we use the harmonic oscillator function as the sort of a ground thing for everything. That is because anything can be approximated by that in some neighborhood. So, it is similar. The problem is that this will not contain the whole of the map. If you want to do that, you have to approximate by more and more accurate a representation of that function. That's all. That's how we do it.
So, if we keep that plane somewhere else, then
it will be different. The only issue is that the qualitative behavior of that map will also be the same, because if it is a period 1 orbit, wherever the Poincare section will be period 1 orbit. If it is a period 2 orbit, wherever you place the Poincare section will be period 2 orbit. So, it does not really depend on where you place it, qualitative character will remain the same.
So
that's all.
In that sense, going from maps to differential equations is completely out of scope.
No, no, because you have lost all. You cannot go back that way. No, this it only says that in any iterate, if it is here, in the next iterate it will be somewhere. So if n is 0, by the same structure of the map you can obtain x 1 y 1. If n is 1, you can obtain x 2 y 2 by the same structure of the map, because all you are doing is to solve the differential equations from this point to that point. That's all. You are solving the differential equation, actually solving. You are not writing the explicit form of the map. I have talked about the non-autonomous and autonomous systems in the class. In the non-autonomous system, there is some external periodic forcing, right? In that case, it is necessary to have the information about the periodicity of the system as injected from outside. Therefore, what we do is we periodically observe it in synchronism with the external periodic input. So, it is not this way, we do not place a Poincare section, rather we periodically observe it. In that case, the time period remains the same. In that case, the time period remains the same. Every same time distance apart, we observe it. And again, we have to solve the differential equations in order to actually obtain the map. Yeah.
Right? That system has its own intrinsic frequency. So why is it obvious that it's always good to look at the period of whatever you're driving it with?
Imagine you have a simple mass spring damper system,
right,
which has its own omega n, natural random frequency. If you drive it with any frequency, it will actually oscillate with the external frequency, not that.
Oh,
it
just
synchronizes. Yeah, it always does that,
yeah,
right? Yeah, that's why we do it. Yes, we are doing it. Yes. Okay. So, is that one clear? Let's come to the next question that came. His question. The question was, how do we actually control chaos? I said that within the chaotic orbit, infinite number of unstable periodic orbits are embedded, and you can control, stabilize any one of them. How? Well, I will not be able to, within the scope of the time that I have, I will not be able to go to the mathematical details of it, but let me give you a feeling how actually it is done. If you have a set of differential equations and you are solving it, then it will be an orbit something like this. And so on and so forth, there will be a large number of points scattered over this plane. What will be the character of the unstable periodic orbit? Say, I am talking about the unstable periodic orbit, which is period 1. It is embedded in the chaotic orbit, and therefore, it is very difficult to find out where it is. But its property will be, since it is periodic, therefore, if you start from a very close neighborhood of that, you will come back to a very close neighborhood of that. And after some time, it will go away, right? So what we do is that we have a large number of practically infinity of points here, but within that data set, we look for close return pairs. That means a pair of points which are close to each other. Maybe here there is one, and then farther down here there is another pair, farther down there is another pair. So we collect that collection of pairs of points which actually just one iterate apart. That means once it was a particular point, next iterate also came to the very close neighborhood. Then when we collect that data, from that data it is possible to identify the actual location of the fixed point. Okay. Unstable, but still we can possibly, you can identify. The mathematics is not very complicated, but a bit, it will take some time to actually work it out. So suppose we have identified where the fixed point is and it is unstable. It is unstable means it is a saddle fixed point, and therefore there would be a stable manifold, there will be unstable manifold. So a saddle fixed point and there will be a stable manifold, there will be unstable manifold. And then at any iterate, remember, if we change the parameter slightly, the position of this fixed point will move, right? So if you change the parameter, the position of the fixed point move, and then I know where the fixed point is, I know where I am now. At any iterate, suppose I am here, I know that I am this much apart, okay. All we do is to calculate, this is easy to calculate such a you know perturbation. We perturb the parameter very, very slightly, small amount, because we apply this technique only when the iterate has come very close to that fixed point. It has come very close somewhere here, and we apply perturbation so that it falls on the stable manifold, and then forget about it, and then withdraw that perturbation. Because it is stable manifold, it will automatically come here, and because the system is chaotic, it will not remain there because it is unstable periodic orbit. It will again wander away. When it wanders away, we apply the perturbation so that it comes to the stable manifold, so on and so forth. So this way it is possible to stabilize those unstable periodic orbits. If you want to stabilize say period 3 orbit, all you need to do when you want to identify this unstable fixed point, you have to look at not only the closed return pairs, but pairs of points that are 3 iterates apart, which are very close to each other. That's all. Otherwise, the same thing works. Okay. Now coming to the third point, third question. If in a chaotic system you cannot predict the future, what can you predict? Why can't we predict the future? Because there is sensitive dependence on initial condition, right? If you try to predict the future, you are obviously giving some initial condition, and unless the initial condition is infinitely precise, you will never be able to predict long into the future. You can predict only a short time into the future depending on the Lyapunov exponent of the system. But what can you really predict? You can predict the statistical property of the system. Okay. For example, if you have a electronic circuit which is chaotic, and there is a current passing which is chaotic, but if you put that in a through that ammeter, what will happen? The ammeter will show something, that is the average value. That is something that can be predicted. So this average values, expectation values, are things that can be predicted. Now how do we do that? Suppose we have, let me illustrate that with the help of the map. Suppose we have a map given, for the sake of simplicity, I will assume a one dimensional map, some function of xn. And as you have seen yesterday, that suppose it is a quadratic, so it will go on like this. So, and all the points will fall in all different places, and ultimately the whole of the x axis, all the real axis will be between 0 and 1 will be filled, right? The whole place will be filled, but not with the same density. Some place will be denser, some place will be less dense. So ultimately we will have to define a density function, that you know how to define the density function. So from there we can obtain a density function. So density function will be something like, say, yes, that's the point. That's the point. The density function will be stationary. So it is something that can be predicted for a system. So even though the system may be chaotic, the density function is something that is stationary and therefore can be calculated. Yes, that can be proved or argued. I'll give something like that. Yes.
But for arbitrary maps, or the maps must have certain properties to be stationary distributions, right?
I'm talking about maps that are chaotic. If it is periodic, then it will be the distribution will be peaky.
Right.
Yeah. So I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a chaotic system. Huh? I'm talking about chaotic map, right? So there will be some kind of a distribution that you will arrive at. How do you get that distribution? How do you calculate the distribution? Pretty simple. You start from any initial condition, iterate, divide this part into bins and find out how many fall in each bin, and for each bin, say from x to x plus del x, in this range whatever the number of iterates that fell divided by the total number of iterates is the row of that particular bin. So here is that bin, this is the value. The question is natural, that is it fixed? Look at it from this angle, that what I, the method of calculating this density function that I just said starts from an initial condition, calculates for a long time, and then looks at the distribution of those numbers, right? Therefore, this is a distribution obtained from the time sequence. Okay, so it is the time average behavior that we are talking about. Now look at it from a different perspective. Suppose I have some kind of distribution. I don't know what distribution it is. Just take some any arbitrary distribution. Say I start from a distribution which is a uniform distribution. And I take a very large number of points distributed according to that uniform distribution, and we iterate the map once. What will happen? They will be redistributed, and therefore I will get from here some other distribution. Say this was in the first iterate, this will be in second iterate, and then so you have a situation where one distribution function maps to another distribution function. You can again take a large number of iterates according to this distribution function, apply the map once, obtain a third iterate another distribution function. Right? This 1, 2, 3 is the iteration numbers that we are making, but in this case we are taking a large number of points and iterating each one of them. Okay? So a large number of points were taken following this distribution function. The distribution function again we take a large number according to this distribution function, this distribution function change. So you see a function is mapping into a function, that function is mapping into a function. So what changes a function into a function? An operator. So therefore what is actually happening is that some operator is operating on the function to give another function. Okay. So the question then boils down to how do we find that operator that operates on a density function to give a new density function, and then if that operator has a fixed point, then your question is answered, right? So it is approached that way. So if you want to figure out what is the, how do you obtain the density function or the operator, this is called the Frobenius-Perron operator. Huh? Yes, yes. There is a Birkhoff's ergodic theorem that says that these two are equal for a chaotic system. Yes, yeah. So this is called the Frobenius-Perron operator. How do you obtain that operator? Suppose I have a function something like this, and I take a range x and x plus, I take a range. Whatever points were there in this range, in the next iterate will be distributed over this range, all right? So the density in this range will be the density in this range divided by the slope here. Clear? So the rho here is equal to rho there divided by the slope. Convincing? Okay. Now it may so happen that this map is like this. If that is so, the density here comes not only from here but also from there. So you have to take not only this one, but also whatever was the number of points here, they also go there. Therefore, we have to we can write the density in the n plus 1th iterate in the y range as density in the nth iterate in x let me say x 1, x 2, the same thing there. Huh? And so on. I mean, it's not, and it can have other chunks also. It will have other chunks. So this is actually the Frobenius-Perron operator. Let me illustrate this with an example. Then only it will be clearer. Had written one example, let me use that. So take this map. How does it look? The graph of the map looks like this. I will divide into three compartments. So it starts from 1/3 and goes to this point and then it goes like this, right? Because for this range it just goes with a slope 1 starting from 1/3, and over this range it just falls to 0 because at xn equal to 1 it is 0, right? Fine. So this is the structure of the map, and we are trying to figure out the density function of this using this. So we will argue this way, that in this part the iterates come from where? It comes from here. So wherever whatever was the density here, it will be divided by the slope here, which is 3. So it will be the p of rho x will be rho n plus 1 in the range 0 to 1/3 will be in this range nth iterate, the last chunk, which is 2/3, 1, divided by the slope, which is 3. Okay. In this part, 1/3 to 2/3, where does it come from? Here it comes from this part, and it also comes from this part. Therefore, it will be rho n 0 to 1/3 divided by, in this part the slope is 1 plus rho n last one 2/3 1/3, the slope is 3. Okay. In the last part, this will be 2/3 1. In this part, where does it come from? It comes from here as well as here. So, it will be 3. See, I have just written this in terms of these 3 chunks. We have assumed that in this chunk, this chunk, this chunk, there would be some density, which are these densities, and we have been able to write the Frobenius-Perron operator. Assuming this interval to be interval 1, this interval to interval 2, this interval to be interval 3, we can compactly write this as rho n plus 1 in the interval I 1 is equal to, or rho n plus 1 in the interval I 2 and rho n plus 1 in the interval I 3. We can write the whole thing as a matrix, is equal to a matrix in the interval I 1. What is this matrix? Easily figure out, it will be 0 0 1/3, it will be 1 0 1/3, 0 1. We have got a nice matrix equation. Now notice the logic. If it at all reaches an invariant density, which will be, that will be the fixed point of this operator. Okay. Invariant means this will be same as this one. So, what is happening? A matrix operating on a vector giving the same vector times 1. So, you have this matrix. How do you extract the information about this invariant density? It is nothing but the eigenvector with eigenvalues 1, right. So, all you need to do from this simple matrix, extract the eigenvector for which the eigenvalue is 1. If you simply calculate the eigenvalues and eigenvector, you will find 1 is 1, and for that particular eigenvalue, just obtain the eigenvector, that is it. Well, because it is a contraction mapping, so therefore it will contract. Its determinant is less than 1, so it will contract. If it is contraction mapping, then it will ultimately, if you apply on something, it will contract, 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 ultimately it will lead to something just fixed. It's that is guaranteed actually. Yeah. Yeah. So did you see? Can you quickly calculate? Kitna time lagega isko calculate karne mein? Karo karo karo. Quickly. Find the eigenvector with whose eigenvalue is 0. Eigenvalue is 1. Uh, Well, like all eigenvector equations, you will get two things through equations that are identical, and therefore you need some additional information in order to actually calculate it. And that additional information is that these are representing densities, and therefore the area under the curve should be 1. So, additional use that you will be able to find it. So, the additional thing that you need is I am denoting the invariant density as star. That should be equal to 1. So, add that information and you will be able to get the value. I suppose if you calculate, you will get this. So, the invariant density curve will be something like this. There will be larger number of points in this chunk, smaller number of points in this chunk, and far less number of chunk in this one. So, it is possible therefore, to calculate the invariant density, a stationary distribution analytically under certain conditions. That condition is that if the map is a piecewise linear map, where the breakpoints map to breakpoints called the Markov maps. Only under that condition we can calculate it analytically, otherwise we need to calculate it numerically. And the numerical calculation can be done in both ways. A, you start from any initial condition, iterate it by time average, you can do that, or you can simply write down the Frobenius-Perron operator for each chunk, assume any initial distribution and simply iterate it numerically, you will converge onto that. Both ways it can be calculated. Both. Oh no, you should simply do both.
Right.
Simply do both and then just check that you are doing the right thing. Okay, let's go to fractals. Okay. Can somebody switch off these lights? Because fractals are colorful and you don't see colors unless you switch off these. And the ones that are very close. Well, in the geometry that you have learnt in school and college, we basically learnt about two kinds of entities. A, objects, and B, space. We have learnt about the geometry of objects in school. We have learnt about geometry of spaces in, you know, college. And the geometrical objects that we learnt about are points, circle, curves, cylinders, rectangular, parallelepipeds, and so on and so forth. Very irregular objects, geometrically regular objects. And space is where the objects live. So, for example, in a point can live in a one-dimensional line, a square can live in a two-dimensional plane, a square can also live in a three-dimensional space. So, space is where the objects live. But we normally study these idealized objects. I mean, these are mental constructs. They do not really occur in nature. We study basically idealized objects. And the idealized space that we studied for very, very long time was the Euclidean space. Well, it is surprising that the narrow confines of the Euclidean space and talking about non-Euclidean space happened before we started talking about non-idealized objects. So, we now understand various types of non-Euclidean spaces, but now we are starting to understand what are non-Euclidean objects. This is a famous quote from Mandelbrot, who first raised this point: the mountains are not cones, clouds are not spheres, lightnings are not straight lines. These are all irregular objects in some way or other. So this is what fractal geometry is all about: the real objects in nature, where we do not make any idealization about the character. So, in what way the real objects are distinctly different from the idealized objects? For example, you consider a where is the pointer? Consider a function drawn as a curve, and you know that you can take a derivative of it. But when you take a derivative, basically what you are doing, you are taking magnifying glass and going closer and closer to it, zooming onto it. And you will be able to take a derivative only when it slowly becomes a straight line. If it does not, you will not be able to obtain a derivative. So, this is how your derivative was defined, but actually the real life objects do not have that property. Look at your skin and look close and closer. You might think that it might, you know, ultimately become a sort of flat surface. It does not. At whatever magnification you may look, it never becomes a flat surface. So, a tree trunk, the curve of share prices, exchange rates, if you really look at those things published in Economic Times, you will find that these are non-differentiable geometrical objects. The coastline, for example. Well, the coastline was a classic example, because in a conference he asked the question, how long is the coastline of England? So, when you do not raise this question, people do not think it is a profound question, but the moment you raise this question, people realize that the length that we measure depends on how big is my yardstick, right? For example, if you have a picture like this, looking from a satellite, then you will be able to measure some distance. What will you do? You will start from at one end and take that yardstick, and how many yardstick lengths you needed, and that way you will simply add them up. As you go closer and closer, you will find that more and more crevices and bends come into view, and you will need a smaller yardstick. And the moment you take a smaller yardstick, the total length calculated goes up. And as you come to the beach, for example, then you see even these are, you know, so you need to have smaller and smaller. That logic does not end. So, in the end, the coastline of England is a curve of infinite length, yet enclosing a finite volume, finite area. Okay. So, this is one important character of a fractal object. Okay. Actually, there are other very important examples. For example, our lungs. Our lungs are made in such a way, I mean, evolution has created in such a way that it has an enormous volume. The volume is fixed, but the enormous surface area, because it has to absorb a large amount of oxygen, and but its volume has to be contained within our rib cage, right? Therefore, its volume is fixed, but the surface area has to be maximized. Yes, yes, of course. Now, the moment I give this talk, I will ask you to look around and look at one non-fractal object. None whatsoever. Everything is fractal around us. And therefore, we are talking about everything under the sun, even the sun. Yes. Because all the time somebody switches on and off some light, because power plant sees only the overall thing, but somebody is switching on and off. So, whenever you find the load is increasing, if you look closer and closer, you will find small light. This guy must be electrical engineer. Okay, so we have to deal with the question of dimension. How do we understand the question of dimension? We more or less understand the dimension as the dimension of the space in which it lives. A flat space, 2D. A line, 1D. So this is how we more or less try to figure out, because this is, but this is actually the dimension of the embedding space. This is not the dimension of the object, and the dimension of the object and the dimension of the embedding space are different. That is something we need to understand. So dimension of the object is characterized by the way it fills space. Now what do we mean by that? What do we mean by that? If you want to try to understand, let's look at this. We know the square is a 2D object, right? But let's analyze how do we get the number 2 out of the square. So suppose I have a square, it is embedded in a 2D space, that's fine. But then the square, I now subdivide the embedding space into smaller and smaller squares, and I ask ourselves how many of these small squares are necessary in order to cover that object. You find that initially when it is just one square, divide into 4 squares, 4 of them, divide to 16 of them, so on and so forth. And if that number, the number of squares, elemental squares needed to cover that object, if it is that n, epsilon is the side length, then that goes as 1 by epsilon square, right, in case of the square. So now that is true for other objects also. For example, I know the triangle to be a 2-dimensional object. How do we get the triangle as a 2D? Here the n, the number of elemental boxes necessary to cover that object, in this case is 3. In this case is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7, 4, 7, 9, 10, right, so on and so forth. And you will find that in this case it goes as half 1 by epsilon square. It ultimately converges onto this number. It does not start with that, all the time it is not that, but it converges onto this number. Similarly, if you do it for a circle which you know to be a 2-dimensional system, it will be pi by 4 and then 1 by epsilon square. For any such object, it will be some k, this will be different for different objects. So we write in general a k, 1 by epsilon square. Yes, you take a circle and you have the box and make it in a grid, and then count the number of grid boxes necessary to cover the circle, you will find that it goes as this. It converges onto this. No, circles, boxes, squared boxes. Yeah, because you have to fill the space. Circles do not fill the space. Yeah, circles do not fill the space. So whatever the object is, that you take a take and no, you can also fill it with triangles, all right, because it fills the space. But it's convenient to fill with squares because that is easy for us to visualize. So ultimately, you will find that it converges onto this pi by 4 1 by 2 square. Okay. Yeah, I'm coming to that. Yes. So starting from there, take a logarithm both sides. You get ln of n. It becomes ln k plus 2 ln 1 by epsilon. Look, I have colored the number 2 because that is where we get the number 2 as the dimension of that object. So we bring it to the left hand side. The dimension is obtained as this expression. Now the question you are raising, let epsilon go to smaller and smaller values. What happens? This term disappears, you get only this term, right? So this k does not really matter, you get the dimension as this. So this is our definition of dimension. This is our definition of dimension of an object. But what are you doing? We are subdividing the embedding space into boxes, and we are counting the number of boxes, that is our n, and the box size is epsilon. If you have that count, then as epsilon goes to 0, whatever value we get, that is our dimension. For example, take an object called the Cantor set, where you take the line segment between 0 and 1. In the first iteration, remove the middle 1/3 and then repeat that process at infinitum. In the next iterate, whatever remains, remove the middle 1/3. In the next iterate, again remove the middle 1/3, and so on and so forth. Ultimately, you get a collection of dust on the real line. What is the dimension of that object? You see, you subdivide the space into elemental boxes. In this case, it's just one dimensional thing. Box means a chunk of line. So divide into three parts. In this case, it is only two of these boxes necessary to cover that object, and each one has a size of 1/3. So it's ln2 by ln3 is 0.63. In the next iterator also, you'll get exactly the same value. Third iterator also, you'll get exactly the same value. So this number remains the same throughout. So even when it becomes a Cantor dust, still the dimension of that object is a fractional dimension. Similarly, this is another construct where you start from a rectangle, right angle triangle, and remove the middle 1/3. In the next iterator, again remove the middle 1/3. Again remove the middle 1/3, again remove the middle 1/3, ultimately you get a structure like this called a Sierpinski triangle. And here also you can easily calculate by the exactly same method, but in this case you subdivide the space in triangles, then its calculation is easy. Then it becomes ln3 by ln2, this number is the dimension of that object. It is not a 2D object, that is what I am trying to point out. It is a fractional dimension. First case. Now, see, this is the construction of the Sierpinski triangle. Ultimately, the Sierpinski triangle is this, not that, but its dimension is 2. Yes, but ultimately, when you have removed, then converges to this, and its dimension will be that.
If you go further, then limit this.
Yes, no. This is the dimension calculated after you have gone infinite number of iterations. Okay. Yes, but how many of these boxes do you need to cover that object? 1, 2, 3. Therefore, it is ln3. Okay. And what is the side of the side length? It is half. Therefore, it is ln2. Similarly, you can have another construct like start from a line, remove the middle 1/3, but then add a triangle like this. In the next iterator, again do this, again do this, and ultimately you will get, I have drawn by hand, and therefore it is after a finite number of iterations, but you can easily imagine that it will have this structure at least geometrically similar to a coastline, and its dimension comes out to be 1.26. So in general, if you take any natural object, this is a picture of a fern, this is a picture of a veins of a on a leaf, and this is the satellite picture of the Himalayas that I took from the net. You can apply the same procedure on any of these objects and you get a number. So what happens is that it always turns out to be a fractional number. Okay. If you take a known idealized object, then it always converges onto a integer number, but if you take a real life object, it always converges to a fractional number. And the geometrical objects with fractional dimensions are called fractals. So simple, just remember the definition of dimension, that does it.
But there are fractal integer
dimensions, right? No, dimensions are fractional dimensions. Which fractals are integer dimension? Fractal definition is that they are This is one type. It's a box counting dimension.
There is the
Hausdorff dimension. Yes, yes.
It's possible that one of these could be an integer.
Yes, yes.
I
have only defined the box counting dimension.
Yes, even the box counting dimension, there can be fractals with integer dimension.
How?
I can give.
Yeah. You can surely give an example. Maybe. Let me finish.
Sir,
yeah. The embedding dimension has to be an integer,
right,
because embedding dimension is given by the degrees of freedom.
That I understand, but
yeah.
Just coming to this point,
yeah.
Suppose I have an embedding dimension of 2 and I get this box counting dimension to be 1 of some object, would I call that a fractal?
No. then it's a very regular object.
Then it's just a curve.
A regular object, yes. Iska. Okay, calculate that. Let's see.
Increasing the epsilon, would it necessarily change the dimension?
Not necessarily. For example, if it is a straight line, it doesn't change. But if it is not a straight line, it does.
The examples that we have seen so far, not, the dimension were not epsilon
dependent, right? The artificially constructed factors that I showed, for them, no, they don't change. But any real life factors,
yes,
they do change. So this fractal dimension has found many uses in various areas of science and engineering also. That's because that quantifies the surface characteristics. For example, the carbon particles in automobile exhaust, they cause harm to your lung, right? And the amount of harm that you will be able to create depends on how much it will stick, and that depends on its surface property. And people have tried to look under the microscope and obtain the fractal dimension and related it to the harm causing ability. Whenever you switch on a switch, two surfaces make contact. Do all the points make contact with each other? No. If you look closely, these are all mountains and valleys, so they make at contact such places, and these are also fractal surfaces. The silt particle in river water, see the silt particles of the same size, same specific gravity, some may be carried, some may be deposited. On what basis? The ones that have larger crookedness of the surface will be carried away easily than the ones that are relatively smoother. So, people have also tried to quantify that. The grain boundaries in metals, semiconductors, alloys, rock structures, there is a whole book on fractals in geology, solid catalysts and electrodes, the amount of reactivity will depend on the amount of surface that is exposed to it. So, these are also so the effectiveness of catalyst depends on the fractal property of those, and so on and so forth. The veins in plant leaves, arteries in veins in your body, tumors and cancer cells. So, cancers have been identified by actually calculating the fractal dimension, and so on and so forth. There have been large number of uses, but today let us not focus on that. Yeah.
So, when you were showing these idealized fractals, there was a perfectly recursive construction,
yeah,
there, right? Now, suppose I bring some sort of imperfections in that recursive construction, I mean, is there a way to quantify the stability of these shapes? Because, I mean, clearly in nature it cannot be that there is a perfectly recursive.
No, no. These perfectly recursive structures are again mental construct.
Right, that's actually true.
Yeah, we construct these fractals in order to sort of
help us
idealize the fractal property,
yes. Yes.
You can say. But in nature that doesn't happen. But I don't know answer to that question whether it will be stable or not.
Right.
That I don't know. No, but you can always apply this procedure. You can always apply this procedure, bring epsilon down, start from a larger epsilon and then bring it down, you will find that it is converging somewhere. You cannot really go down to zero because then it will become molecular dimension, that you cannot do. But it goes to some value and just extrapolate it there and find where it meets. That's what the dimension. The question is, how is fractal geometry relevant in dynamics? We are studying dynamics here. We in dynamics, for example, let me exemplify this issue. Let there be a dynamical system like this, it is a map. Z is a complex number, Z is in the tth iterate, Zt is the complex number, and t plus 1 iterate is complex number. If it is a complex number, then it can be plotted on the complex plane, right? C is another complex number which is a parameter. So, Z is a variable and C is a parameter. So, for every value of C, you can start from a value of Z and see whether it becomes bounded or not. It can run to infinity or it can remain bounded. So, if you do that, you get nice pictures like this. So this is the x coordinate, this is the x coordinate means real axis, imaginary axis, in that you get nice pictures. So this is a fractal in the state space. The actual, do you know what this is? Just the basin of attraction. Just the basin of attraction, because what was the basin of attraction? We said the range of initial conditions from which it goes to a particular stable behavior. This is also the collection, the red dots are the collection of those points, those initial conditions from which it goes to the stable behavior. So it is a and for different values of c you get nice objects, you can make saris with it. So you can easily design saris with, nowadays the people are actually doing it. So for different values of the parameter you get different Julia sets, these are called Julia sets. And then you can also have the c is also c is a parameter, that is also a complex number, and therefore you can also have the vary the c and see whether the behavior is bounded or not. You get a structure like this, and this is called the Mandelbrot set, and this is also a fractal. So this is a fractal in the parameter space. Julia set was a fractal in the phase space. So obviously for different values of the parameter, if I choose a parameter from here, it will, I get one Julia set, I get a parameter from here, I get another Julia set, so on and so forth. So there are infinite number of points here, there are infinite number of possibilities in Julia sets. Huge number of possibilities in Julia sets, which are nice stuff. And as you zoom closer and closer into any of these, you find structures within structures. It never smoothens out into some flat surface. For example, this was one part of this. If you look at this part, it was here. In this part, we have zoomed, and then as you zoom, you get this. You zoom in, you get this. You zoom in, you can get further. So on and so forth. You can zoom in further. If you search the net, you will find a program called fractint. It is an integer programming. So fractint, fractint, you can play with it. It's very nice, and you can design your own fractals. So the Julia sets are fractals in the phase space, and the Mandelbrot set are the fractals in the parameter space. And there would be a Julia set for every point in the Mandelbrot set. So for a point here, you get this as a Julia set, a point here, you get this as a Julia set, and so on and so forth. There will be an infinity of them. And it is really fun to do it. So by all means, writing this program is only a 10 line of code. So you can easily write it and have fun with it. Because it is an extremely simple differential, extremely simple map, where this is just only this. You only have to work with complex numbers, that's all, nothing more. Okay. Now let's come to a bit of theoretical structure of it. So far I was sort of having fun. Let me now come to a bit of theoretical structure of it. Basically, what are you doing? What are fractals? If it is in 2D, it is basically a picture. Right? A picture is nothing but a subset of the R2 space. Right? If you draw something on your copy, there is nothing but a subset of the R2 space. Convinced? So in mathematics, it is working? That's strange. It was not working so far. So any black and white image is nothing but a set of points, which is nothing but a compact subset of the R2 space. The compact means it doesn't go to infinity, a subset obviously, because it doesn't cover the whole of the R2 space. So now we define a space whose elements are compact subsets of the R2 space. Okay. That means all the pictures that have been drawn in this world and all the pictures that will be drawn in this world and all the pictures that will not be drawn in this world are members of this space. Okay.
May or may not be factors,
all pictures included. Now, we define a metric, a distance between two elements of such a space, which means the distance between two pictures. How do we do it? In order to define a metric, we have to satisfy a few conditions. A, the distance has to be positive. The distance will be 0 only if A is equal to B, and distance between A to B is same as its distance between B to A, and the triangle inequality distance between A to B plus distance between B to C should be greater than distance between A to C. These four conditions must be satisfied. Okay? Now, we somehow have to figure out a way of defining a distance between two pictures. How different are they? Some measure of that. So, suppose there is a distance between point and a point, we know simply Euclidean distance. Now, we define the distance between a point and a set, d distance between an element, a point, and a set B. We define it as the minimum distance between A and all the points of B. You can always define it that way. Good. Now, we have to define the distance between a set and a set, the distance between A and B. So, you can now take all the points and define this distance to all the points here and take the max of that. So, if you have done that, you might be satisfied that I have got something. No, this does not satisfy the equality between A to B and B to A, and therefore, if you have obtained these two distances, take the bigger of the two. This symbol means the bigger of the two. Okay. Take the bigger of the two, then this satisfies all the conditions of being a metric, and then we call it a Hausdorff metric between two elements of the two such objects. So, we have defined a metric. Yes, you can easily find, just make a overlap, you will find that happens. If there is a bit of overlap, that will happen. Now, it becomes a metric space therefore. The space that we have defined the elements and we have defined a metric, and therefore, it becomes a metric space. And there are a few properties of metric space that we can immediately apply. One property is that there can be Cauchy sequences, convergent sequences. Okay. So, if x comma d is a metric space, then a sequence x n is said to be a Cauchy sequence. If, by the way, have you attended any class on functional analysis? Not yet? Oh, then I have to do this, otherwise I could have possibly skipped. So, it is said to be, it is basically a convergent sequence, and the convergent sequence in the real number space is very simple, you can easily define that, but now we are generalizing that in any possible space, and that is how we define it. It is said to be a Cauchy sequence if for every arbitrarily small number epsilon, there exists a positive number n such that the distance between two objects x m and x n should be less than epsilon for every m and n bigger than n. So, in this sequence, there should be some number n such that after that, the distance between two elements will be smaller than that epsilon. If that condition is satisfied, the sequence is a Cauchy sequence, and we know that Cauchy sequences converge. So, Cauchy sequences converge to a fixed point. So, do you see where we are trying to arrive at? We are trying to arrive at a way by which we will define Cauchy sequences in the space of images. Let us see. So, in order to define a Cauchy sequence, I have to go from one point to another point. Therefore, I have to define some way of jumping from a point to the another, right? So, or mapping. So, suppose a point can be mapped to another point by the transformation T, a mapping T. It will be called a contraction mapping If I have two points and I apply the transformation T on both of them, thus giving me T x and T y. If the distance between T x and T y is smaller than the distance between x and y, that is what is written here, then this mapping is contractive. Okay. So, we will need a contractive mapping. It is less than equal to S times d x y, where x is a smaller than 1. There is a celebrated theorem by Banach, that is called Banach's contraction mapping theorem, which says that if x and d is a complete metric space, complete means there is no holes in it. It is a metric space in which all Cauchy sequences converge onto points that are elements of the space, and then T is a contraction mapping, then T has a unique fixed point. That is the main point of this Banach contraction mapping theorem. Let us see how it is proved, because that proof we will need later. Suppose you have a sequence x 1, x naught, x 1, x 2, x 3, and somewhere down the line we have the x m and x m plus 1, and then it continues. The distance between these two elements here, since x m is obtained by applying t on x m minus 1, I can write it like that, and x m plus n is obtained as t operating on x m, we can write it like that. And now, since it is t x m minus 1 t x m, I can just by the definition of contraction mapping, I can get s out and write less than equal to. And in next step, we go one step backwards, next step we go one step backwards, and ultimately we get s to the power m times the first two points at their distance between them. Okay. Now, we consider any two points x m and x n in that sequence. Between these two points, there are many points inside. So, by triangle inequality, this distance should be smaller than all these distances put together. What is happening? What is it? Electrical engineer? Some feedback is happening, but this I did not know that it happens. Anyway. So this one, by the what we did in the last slide, it will be s to the power m distance between the first two points. This will be s to the power m plus 1 distance between the first two points, so on and so forth. So, this can be taken out, leading to this sequence here. Again, s to the power m can be taken common, leaving this. So, if this is here, then you can also add another infinity of terms, so that this can continue to infinity, because you are writing less than equal to, it will still be satisfied if you add terms here. So, this we know is simply 1 by s, 1 by 1, 1 by 1 minus s. So, notice the result. Since s is smaller than 1, therefore, as m n tends to 0, this distance will tend to 0, and therefore, this will be Cauchy sequence, and if it is a Cauchy sequence, it will have a fixed point and it will converge onto a fixed point. I will need this result later, that is why I just showed the derivation of it. Now, the question is, how do we define a mapping? The simplest possible mapping we will take, just affine mapping. Just affine transformation. So, if it is x y times a matrix plus a displacement, x displacement is E, y displacement is F. So, this is a simple affine transformation. A point can be transformed. If a point can be transformed, all the points inside a set can also be transformed. So, by the same mapping, a point can map to a point, a set can map to a set. Okay? Good. I will skip the proof. If you want, I can go through it, but the question is the resulting mapping contractive? There is a proof that says that yes, the resulting mapping will also be contractive. That means, if it is a one contraction mapping applied on the set, you get a set, that mapping is also contractive. Now, what we do, we have say a original picture. I have one contraction mapping. Applying on all the points of this set, I get one set. I get, I have another contraction mapping applying all the points on the set, I get another set, and another third one, I get a third set, and then we even take union of them, you get some object. You can also do that, right? The question is that will that be contractive? Will that be a contraction mapping? Actually, yes, provided each of these are contractive. That means each of these, the matrix, if this matrix has eigenvalue less than 1, then this mapping will also be contractive. Here is the proof, but I will not go into the proof. If you want, I can. If you want, I can always come back to the proof. So, to summarize, I am actually trying to keep some time for question answers. That is why I am not going through all the proofs. I will leave the slides here. If anybody wants, copy it, read it later, no problem. So, if we can define affine transformations W1, W2, W3, etcetera, as contractive, very easy to ensure. All that you need to do is to have the eigenvalues are of the matrix are less than unity, then the total mapping will be contractive. And if the mapping is contractive, then the Banach's contraction mapping theorem ensures that starting from any initial set, any initial picture, if you apply that, it will converge onto, it will always converge. And converge onto what? An element of the space, which is what? A picture. So, notice that I have a space where each element is a picture. I have defined a way of stepping in that space, and the steps will progressively become smaller and smaller and smaller, and ultimately I will stop at a picture. And provided that picture is a beautiful one, I am nice. Okay? So, let us see. Suppose I have defined this set of contraction mappings. Each of these matrices have eigenvalue less than 1. So, this is the whole thing is a contraction mapping, and then I apply it on a very, very simple set, the square. Okay? Apply it once, I get this. So, the first mapping gives this, second one gives this, third one gives this, fourth one gives this. This whole put together is a union, is a picture now. Now, I will apply all the mappings on this whole picture, I get this. I apply the mapping again, I get this. I apply the mapping again, I get this. And finally, I get this.
No, upside down.
What? No. No, no, no. No, no, no. I just showed. I just showed. You don't get it on a sixth step. If you maybe 25.
Yes. That's impressive. Yes.
So I'm just trying to impress you.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So see the power of mathematics, that we defined a few affine transforms and applied on anything. Now remember, this is this the in space of the square. If you start from your own picture, it will still converge onto this. Yes.
In all of the transforms.
Yes.
But in the last picture.
No, no, it's that.
So, how is it possible?
No, no, oh, what is happening is that you see, in this chunk there is a head. In this chunk there is a head. In this chunk there is a head. So, heads are there in all of them.
The bigger one
is the head of the whole one. And no, 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 you just keep on applying for a long time, that disappears.
Yeah.
Yeah. So ultimately you get this. Now when I give this talk, normally people think that I have some godly power so that I got this numbers. I get this number. Where do I get these numbers? Huh? So ye numbers kahan se aa gaya? So that is what normally the question is, yes? Other way back means? We did something from the fern, yes, that's true. That's not the backtracking. There's a very well defined procedure for that, I'll tell you that. But I didn't backtrack, no. not that way.
Number
kahan se aaya? Okay, so I need to tell you number kahan se aaya. For example, if you apply on the square, you have another set of numbers. If you apply the square, you get the CRPC triangle, and you can actually generate anything. Even your picture, I can code your picture in a set of numbers. I will apply on his picture, it will converge onto your picture. Because the initial condition does not matter, right? The initial condition does not matter. I once took the picture of Sophia Loren and it converged onto my picture. It was so. Okay, so how do we construct the iterator function system? It's called iterated function system.
But is it possible with only one map?
Yes, only one map.
No, here you have
taken. No, not with one map, no. Actually, the whole map is a union of all those four maps.
No. Just to take one map.
No, it will not work. It will not work. It will not work. Yes. At least two. Yeah.
Each one is linear.
Yeah, if you take just one map, it will become smaller and smaller and smaller and it will go to zero. It will not work. Okay, now number kaisa hai? That's the question I'm trying to answer now. Suppose you have got in your mind some image L. And suppose you construct an iterated function system with contractivity factor that's less than 1, such that if you apply this W on L, the distance between the original picture and the transformed picture is very small, then the Banach contraction mapping theorem says that the distance between, see, this was one step in that Banach contraction mapping theorem. So, in that, let m go to 0, that means it becomes the initial condition, n go to infinity, that becomes the attractor after a large number of iterations. So, the distance between the initial condition and the attractor will become a very small number, because this for s is small, what is happening? For s is small, that will go to 0. So, essentially what it says that try to do something so that after one iteration of the mapping, that number of mappings, take the union, and then whatever picture you get is a very close resemblance of the original picture. Okay. Let us see how to do it. Suppose I want to construct the IFS, the iterated function system, the collection of mappings for this Sierpinski triangle. Notice that the Sierpinski triangle is self-similar. This part is similar to the whole, this part is similar to the whole. So, the whole thing, I can always define a contraction mapping that will give only this part, another mapping will give only this part, third mapping will give only this part, union is the same as this, right? Then you can easily write down by hand, you can write down the contraction mapping. Now, start from any orbit object and apply this, you will always get the Sierpinski triangle. Okay. Say the fern. Notice the fern has also self-similarity. This whole thing is similar to this whole part. This whole thing is also similar to this part. This whole thing is similar to this part, and this stem can also be obtained as an affine transformation of the whole. Right? All you need to do is to obtain these affine transforms. Now, you can how for example, how can we get this chunk from the whole? Not difficult at all, because you know this point will map to this point, you know this point will map to this point, you know this point will map to this point, right? Three points, if you simply write down, it becomes a six equations, six unknowns, you can solve it. Okay. So, you can solve it and then obtain the numbers by which actually we did exactly that. It is not magic that I had. We did exactly that in order to get the numbers, and when we iterated that, I got this form. Ah, yes. Dikhaunga. So, suppose we have got a beautiful face like that and we can compress it. एज नंबर्स. ये कैसे हो गया? वी कैन कॉम्प्रेस इट एज अ नंबर. सो वी कैन कॉम्प्रेस इट एंड वी गेट ए फ्यू नंबर्स विच मीन्स अ वेरी वेरी कॉम्प्रेस थिंग एंड देन वी स्टार्ट फ्रॉम एनी ऑब्जेक्ट आर्बिट्ररी ऑब्जेक्ट विच इज जस्ट रैंडम. I apply it once, I get this. Apply it another time, I get this. Apply it third time, I get this. Apply it fourth time, I get this. By the sixth time, I get this.
But the university
was possible. Why should I do that? No. You could have started instead of this. You could start from his face. Doesn't matter. You could still converge onto this.
That's a fixed point you already
know. That is the fixed point, right? Okay. Now another question, how do we get this? How do we do this? This is actually done by one of not the picture, but the compression. the picture is a very standard picture for any work on image processing. This is the Lina picture, very standard benchmark picture at least. So what we actually do is we try to find out the self similarity within the picture. Now, looking at this picture, it may not immediately be clear where is the self-similarity. But the cheek, this skin color and this color is similar, and therefore, if I take a box and that can be mapped into a box here. So, there is a program that sort of searches within the picture as to which box can be transformed into which box. And ultimately, what we save is essentially which box maps to which box maps to which box, and that information is saved, not the picture information. So, if that information is applied on any picture, it ultimately converges onto this. Okay. So, fun, a lot of fun. Thank you. So, if you have questions, you ask. I have kept 10 minutes for that. Deliberately, I if you have a question, you ask. No problem. Yeah. Leaf. Yeah. Fern.
The lower part. How does that?
Oh, okay, okay, okay. Let's go. Yes. Which one? Green one. Okay. Where is the pointer? Keep it. Yeah. So the whole thing, how can it map to this? That's the question. All you need to do is to do something in the matrix so that it contracts to 0. Anything in the y-axis, anything in the x-axis will contract to 0. How do you do that in a matrix? Just easily visualizable. What will make all the x coordinates 0? This 0 0, first line has to be 0, and this is actually the scaling. That's it. Not difficult at all. This can be written by hand. The rest cannot be written by hand, but this one can be written by hand. Any other question? Which one?
The very last image.
Okay, let me do it explicitly. Say this is the whole image. We divide this into boxes. And and take say this box, and we search the whole image for some box of larger size, because it has to be contraction mapping. So a larger box where given an affine transformation, it can regenerate this box. So we search the whole image for a self similar box of larger size. Okay, so if you have found it, then just keep that information of the location of that box. That's enough. Go to the next one, search the whole image. Go to the next one, search the whole image. That way. So that's why the compression time is a little larger than the usual JPEG format. So when we did this work for the first time, the compression time was reasonably large, and when we started this work, the computers were also pretty slow. So the person who actually generated this theory, Michael Barnsley, he quit his university, started a company, and made a chip which specifically does that. Okay, but ultimately he could not make money, so he quit, because this fractal image compression could not compete with JPEG standard. Okay, but over the last 2 years, our group has succeeded in matching the JPEG standard. So we are now able to get compression as well as speed better than the JPEG standard. Chip we don't need, because we do it on the computers. Because they wanted to make a dedicated chip, because it requires a huge amount of parallel computation, because when this one is searching, another search can also go on, and third search can also go on. They are independent searches. So they did it by parallel computation. We found that is not really necessary. Then we use not very mathematical procedure, but computer science techniques to do that. That depends on the self similarity of the image. If it is very self similar, you need very small number.
So how many was for the picture?
For the picture, that's quite a large number. That's quite a large number, because we normally divide the picture into boxes of 4x4 pixels, and we search the 8x8 pixels, and we search the image for 16x16 pixels. So then, depending on the number of pixels in the whole image, you need that many affine transformations. So that number is large, but after all, these are numbers, can be compressed very easily. Yeah. If just four can make that, and also see. Have you seen Jurassic Park carefully?
Yes.
So many of the images are just made by this. Many of the images are made by this. And the way to make a fractally generated tree move in the breeze is just change the parameters. Sinusoidally vary the parameters. The whole tree moves like a breeze. In a breeze. You can do that. Very interesting thing to do. A tree can be constructed like this. And so on and so forth. So this is a self-similar structure, can be made just with three mappings, and then change the parameters, you will find this is moving like this. So change the parameter sinusoidally. No. The definition has the ln epsilon tends to 0.
But this is the structure.
In that particular iteration, it will have that number.
Each block will do the same. Now there will be 9 boxes. Each of the 9 boxes will do the same process. It goes on infinity.
Yeah, if you go that take it to infinity, then the dimension is definitely fractal. It's not in integer.
No,
what? How do you get an integer number? Show.
log 9 by log 3.
log 9 में log 3 कैसे आ गया? Yes.
So you counted the number of triangles which is equal to fill up the space divided by linear dimension, right? Yeah.
Huh.
So next part. So the number of triangles equal to fill up the space, which is 3.
Yes.
Divided by log of that, log of 3 divided by log of 2.
Yeah.
The first part.
Yeah.
So I am just saying that if you have a cube.
Yes.
The number of thing in the next instant to fill up the space would be 9.
Yes.
And the dimension is 3.
So yes.
Log 9 by log 3.
So you are talking about a cube.
Yes. And then divide it into 9 parts. Sorry, 27 parts. 3 by 3.
Huh. So you are now dividing it into this kind of boxes, right?
And keep 9 and
keep 9 and how do you keep 9? Okay, keep 9.
Erase the rest, delete the rest.
Okay.
So then the construction is the cube, and the cube, make into 27 parts, keep 9 parts, erase the rest. So
okay.
Next one also for each cube you do the same, and it goes on. So the pattern you get is that the dimension is log 3 divided by log 9 divided by log 3. Because
yes, log 9 by log 3, yes. Yeah, okay. I understand what you mean. You just construct in such a way that it becomes an integer.
Yeah.
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 Limit on the order of the self similar property. Oh, okay. In practical things that we see around you, we subdivide it. For example, if you subdivide me, at some stage you will come to molecules, and then you don't really look inside further. So what we do is essentially, epsilon does not really go to zero, but go to some number at which you can really resolve, and then after that we simply extrapolate that line. What do you mean by that order?
If you
zoom into that, you see the self-similar structure in any level of zooming. You will see the fern. Look at the fern. The structure you will find that. This whole thing looks like the whole. So there's self-similarity within self-similarity.
If I apply this on the coastline, right?
Yeah.
So observable the coastline that.
Yeah. I mean, these are constructed factors where you can guarantee that at every level of magnification you will see, but in the coastline at some level you will get in become molecules, right?
So,
all right, let's end. Thank you.
Okay, so